Thanks for coming, everyone. I'm Nat Castriata. I'm the local systems engineer here for New England for MapR. I've been with MapR for about close to 2 years now. I'd like to introduce you to Paul Curtis. Paul is one of our field engineers in MapR, so Paul does a lot of these meetups. Paul is deep in the technology, been working for MapR for probably, what, 4 or 5 years now? 5 years. So Paul is one of the early employees at MapR. What Paul's going to show you today is some of the capabilities that can be done on our platform, right? We're not here to show you MapR. We're here to show you the capability that our platform can provide. And then from there, you'll be able to see that with a single converged platform, you can do a lot of things that you can't do necessarily with some of the other platforms. So take it away, Paul.
So I'll do my own introduction slide. So this is not a MapR-specific thing. There is one MapR-specific slide, okay? This is Spark and Kafka and Java, for the most part. All right, so who am I? Matt told you. I was the first SE for MapR in the Northeast. So I've seen Hadoop and big data go from trying to get Hadoop to run at all to the kinds of things that we're doing today. What I want to get into and talk to you tonight is how you do high velocity processing. So one of the things that Hadoop was never very good at in the very beginning was dealing with data coming in at a high rate, okay? So a lot of the big data projects that would have benefited from big data really were almost impossible to do, okay? Because Hadoop was not designed to do it. It was a batch-oriented system, but it had a lot of nice things that people liked, like low-cost storage, replicated, very resilient. People like that, right? So we're going to talk about stock market trade data. Now, how many are familiar with the financials? Oh, that's good. Okay, so for the financial people, the demo and the data that we use is quote and tick from the New York Stock Exchange for a given day. Okay, so that kind of data set, when you look at it, the trade day for the New York Stock Exchange is 6.5 hours. So in a given day, there's 4 to 6 million executions. That's not a very big number, okay? However, when you go to the next line and you begin to look at the quotes, bid and ask, that number is easily one, if not two, orders of magnitude larger. And granted, these are really small records. I mean, they're tiny, right? So a quote or a trade record is maybe 75 bytes. Total. So the data set that you get out at the end of the day is not actually all that big in the big data world. At 450 gigabytes approximately, and that would be full level two, for those who know what that is. That's full bid and ask. So why is it this way for those who aren't in the finance industry is high frequency trading has done something that's very interesting. So they'll watch for a price change or an action or something. And rather than the old days where a human would say, I'll sell my shares at 10 bucks and somebody will bid at $9.90, they will put in 1,000 bid and asks with very small increments of bid and ask price. And they'll do 1,000 of them in a millisecond, or maybe 2 milliseconds, right? That's why the order of magnitude is so different. Eventually, the computers or a human will decide that they're going to execute. So that's why it's that different. And so when you look at the data set, it's not all that big. What you have to realize is that that's 20 megabytes per second. Megabytes, that would be, okay, times 10, it's 200 megabits. Right? So it's not something you're going to see going into a single node of a single trading machine very easily. Now, how is this done at the market level? They use multiple interfaces and things like that. But that's a lot of data. So the other thing to look at is that in that, there's 8,000 equity symbols. We're not talking about options or anything else. Okay, so forget all that. That's a whole other universe. We're talking about just straight equities. Now, buy a stock, sell a stock. And in that set, there's about 2,300 buyers and sellers that deal with the New York Stock Exchange. So we were asked at one time to do this was to kind of build out an application that allowed you to do time windowing and look at this in real time. So, the biggest problem here is that without having to do any processing, zero processing, I have to deal with that throughput. Right? Hadoop doesn't do that. I mean, doesn't do that. If you can get HDFS to write at that rate, you're doing pretty well. Okay? If you can get one box to accept it at that rate, you're doing pretty well. Right? So you have fundamentally built into the platform you have a problem. So how do you deal with high velocity data? So the old Hadoop way, this is the traditional Hadoop way, was to take the data coming in and split it. You'd write some out, the batch type part, you just write it to the file system as fast as you could. And then sometime at night, you'd run a big old Hive query or something like those and all that kind of stuff. And you'd create static views of the data, right? So that's these batch views up here. And then you'd have another path down here that typically was storm over here in the process stream. And storm would take those things and update some real-time index. A lot of times it was Elasticsearch or tools like that. Sometimes it was just straight key value stores like HBase, okay? But what that meant was is that A, you needed two sets of processing to do this, and B, this one had to be able to do it at speed. So I never in my career at MapR saw anybody take the full feed at full speed in the Hadoop platform up until very recently. Because it's very hard to do this at speed. I mean, I can scale storm, I can do all kinds of things, but it gets really hard really quick to do that. And the last part of this is you had to serve it up. So if somebody said, I want to see the last 60 seconds of data, that's easy, because that's all down here. What if I want to see the last 5 days? Well, I need this data plus this data. And all of a sudden the client application gets a little more complicated. I will provide the slots, I promise. Okay, so now let's bring in the newer way people do this. So streaming technology in the Hadoop world got introduced with Kafka. And Kafka is not a message queue in the way that people think of MQ or Rabbit or one of those things. It is not a transactional queue. It is a publish-subscribe mechanism. So there are some number of producers over here on the left. There can be more than one. And they publish into a pipe. And then there can be some number of consumers who read that pipe. Now, that's great. That solved a couple of problems because I can have multiple producers, I can get a lot in the pipe, I can really get all that data going down here, okay? And then I could filter it or display it and I could do real-time kinds of views of data. The downside of this is that if you look at this picture, it means that every client has to see all the data. Right? So we haven't solved the throughput problem. We haven't solved the network problem. We haven't solved the CPU problem. So while this approach works, you have to have some fairly powerful machines at the other end to be able to do this. So far, everybody pretty much on board with this. This is a traditional streaming technology. If you were using ultra messaging or something like that, the high-speed message buses, this is basically what you would be looking at. Because they didn't segregate the data. They let the client at this end do that. It was their responsibility. Problem with it is it doesn't scale. You have 500 traders, you got to push the data to 500 people. That's 500x the network traffic. It's not going to scale. You're going to burn out your infrastructure. You also need all these processors over here to do that. So, a different way to approach this is rather than trying to see how much data you can jam down one pipe, how about we be a little smart and think about what the user wants to see, what the end user's goal is, and the kinds of data sets that they're looking for. Because you're not going to want to see all 8,000 equities. You might want to see 1,000. You might want to see 500. You might want to see 200. Why should you get all 8,000 when all I want is this little set? Okay, and the other case is the application that we're demonstrating was actually built for a financial company. They wanted to know who was doing the bid and ask, so the senders and receivers. okay? So we take a different design pattern. The design pattern is pretty simple. You have all the data coming in from wherever it's coming from. And the first thing you do is you split it up. You actually look at the data and say, let's be intelligent about how we're going to build this out. So rather than having one pipe with all, one topic with all data, what if I had 8,000 topics with one equity per topic? For example, an IBM topic, an AT&T topic. We solve two problems here, right off the bat. The first one is, I don't ship you all 8,000 equities, and you get to pick the ones you want to watch, okay? And this can be done in software very easily. This little box in the middle that takes all senders and fans them out is a really simple Java program that is a Kafka consumer and a Kafka producer, but produces on one through n number of topics. Okay, so it fans this out, and this actually requires no intelligence. All it has to do is say, I just need to read the equity, take that, and use that as the topic name, and then publish to it. This can be parallelized very easily. So if one process can't do it, five processes probably could. In our tests where we did full speed, and to, in our world, full speed was about 300,000 messages a second. It took three consumers to do the fan out. So that's nothing. Yeah, you're going 300,000, yeah, it's 300,000. The demonstration on my laptop with one will do about 150,000 messages per second. Well, this idea is pretty straightforward, but it gives you a whole set of other things that you can do. So these little microservices, this guy, is really not a very intelligent thing. But when you begin to chain them together, it gets much more powerful, much quicker. So the first one may be the guy who fans it out. The second one might be the guy who's doing the predictive bid and ask, or trending, or whatever you want him to do. And he could be writing to another stream. You can just cascade these things together. These little pieces of code are very small, very tight, and very specific to one task, and they use streams to communicate back and forth. Now, is everybody comfortable with, when I say streams, you understand that this guy is publishing here, this guy is consuming, and then republishing something different. So if you take the storm paradigm of bolts and spouts, he's a spout, but he's a bolt and a spout. And he's a bolt and a spout. Okay, so the reason that this works is that Kafka can scale horizontally very nicely. So you can do this kind of volume on a Kafka cluster. All right? The downside of Kafka comes a little bit later, and we'll talk about some of its limitations. So what does the whole architecture look like? Sorry, this is one of the MapR specific streams because it wouldn't be edited out. So what we did was we took the quote and trade from December 13th, 2013 for the New York Stock Exchange. It was a free piece of data. And that is the quote and trade, but it's not the bid and ask. Okay, so it's not level two data. What we did was we synthesized the level two data. Right, so we said, we know how they do it. We know how that algorithm works. So let's just generate the data. And we did. So the demonstration that you'll see is a very short version of the one that we did, but you'll get the general idea of what goes on. That feeds into a single stream in Kafka, a single topic in Kafka as well. It is partitioned. Okay, so it'll scale out. We found that we could do it with three partitions and get 300 to 400K a second out of that. And that's pretty reasonable. This little part, this microservice, is the one that I'll show you. It's a very simple fan out. It consumes the raw text stream. It reads the equity symbol. Actually, in our case, it's reading the senders, the bid and ask, people who created the bid, and the people they sent it to, senders and receivers, and fans them out. So that when you get to the far end of this, over here, now I can pick and choose exactly what I want to watch. I don't have to filter at the client level anymore. So if I have a trader who's only interested in two currencies, he only reads two topics, right? And he can do whatever he wants with that data in Spark. And these are very low impact applications because they're not dealing with 150,000 messages a second. They're dealing with 100 messages a second, okay? For currency, and on some equities, it's even lower than that. Or he can do 20 of them, and they can deal with this. The code is the same, but all they have to do is say, I want to watch IBM, AT&T, and Apple. He wants to watch these three. Okay, so it becomes very simple. He can pick and choose. The topics are dynamic names, right? They're strings in Kafka. Pretty straightforward. All right? You can use standard Spark streaming to do this, which is what we're going to talk about and kind of show you what that looks like. The display part of it can be whatever you want. All right, so in one case, we're rolling data in on 15-minute intervals, so we have a D stream with a 15-minute interval that just writes it out for archival purposes. But the Spark SQL is actually doing moving time with us, which is what I'm going to show you. All right, so the ability to say, I'm going to query the stream for the last 60 seconds. No matter what time of day it is, I'm going to only take the last 60 seconds of trades, or bids, or asks, or whatever you're looking at. So far, does that all make sense? Any questions?
So Spark components client-side then in that model? You're saying
yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so typically, if you think about running Spark standalone on a laptop, just in a window, it could take probably a couple thousand a second on my laptop without any problem and do this kind of level of processes. The code is going to be exactly the same whether it's you or everybody else in the room. The only difference is the topic names. And since the topic names are strings, give them a selection list. Give them the name of the topic. Doesn't really matter. The code is very generic, so you'll see what I did or what. Actually, I didn't write a portion of this, I wrote some of it. But you'll see the technique for doing it. Okay, so on a different point of view, to wrap this up, one of the reasons that this works is that you parallelize two things. You parallelize the data flow, meaning that you're not duplicating 300,000 messages per second across 100 machines. Okay, so you can parallelize that. And the second thing is that because the client doesn't have to do heavy-duty lifting, all it has to do is subscribe to 3 or 4 topics or 10 topics. It doesn't have to do the filtering, so it doesn't have to work at the rate. It's a low impact, right? Very low impact. So we run this stuff as demos in the back. It's kind of fun, but basically that conceptually does it. There's one other thing to keep in mind that we're going to talk about. Java and Scala and Python and R all have one big problem. They are going to be fat slower than any stream that you're going to bring in. So you're going to have to look to how to optimize your data, right? If your requirement is to have immediate presentation, you're going to have to get into not filtering or doing any processing at all and building your display mechanism, whether it be a browser display or an application display, to deal with the stream in its raw form, okay? Because if you want to transform it into any kind of data format that's nice, like JSON, or you know, even just parsing out this record into something nice, that will cost you time, especially in Java. string manipulation, like not its strong point, okay? Python the same way, Scala's better, but not much better. So chances are, even a really high-end machine is probably not going to be able to deal with this at a client level to do display. That one little microservice, because it's so focused, and all it has to do is look at these 16 characters, don't care about anything else, to be able to put it in the right topic, it's able to keep up at speed. But even there, we needed three of them to deal with the message. So couldn't do it even on one. So that gives you the general idea of how this goes. I would skip this MapR slide, but since Matt mentioned it, I'm gonna leave it in here. So MapR is a platform, is a converged data platform, which is a very nice marketing term for being able to build a cluster that has more than, that does more than one thing. Okay, so we were a Hadoop distribution when we started, so we have a file system distributed. We have added an HBase key value store, so a columnar NoSQL to that. We've added a JSON document NoSQL to that, as well as streams, all on one platform. So basically, you don't, in MapR, my world, you don't have a separate Kafka cluster, an HBase cluster, and a Hadoop cluster. They're all one. Same boxes. So that's one of the things that we do, and it makes this demo really easy because I don't have to install three things. I can do it all on one. Okay, any questions so far before we like leap in?
What's a turnaround for changing your filter strings? What's the turnaround time for changing your filter strings if you're a client?
So in the Kafka world, you're going to do a subscribe. So what you would have to do is you'd have to unsubscribe and resubscribe with a new topic string. And the problem, you have to be a little careful doing that on the fly. Because by default, and this is a Sparkism, in Spark, the default is to give you everything on that topic. Okay? So before you have to take a little bit of a design pattern here and think that if he's going to switch like that, I'm going to have to load up my offsets so that I know how to do those windows. And you will take the hit once, but once you've done it, you're fine. The subscribe unsubscribe is functionally instantaneous. Okay, it's very straightforward.
So it's feasible to change it during the day or even multiple times during the day.
Yeah.
You just need to order it in the right order so you don't get the flow of flood.
Right. Or you take the whole flood, you eat it, and you toss what you don't want. Okay. So either way, the thing that you don't get in Kafka by default, and definitely not in Spark, is the ability to do that based on time. Because there's nothing in a message in the Kafka stream that says what time it came in. It'll tell you in order how they came in, but it won't tell you when. So IBM might have traded at 9:30 and 10:30. To you, you're getting them right next to each other in time. That's part of what the code does. And
I was just curious, in the demo you made, how big a system did you build for this? Why don't you fan out how many nodes of Hadoop did you have on the right side?
Three. Okay. So the tick data stream had one producer and three consumers to do the fan out at full speed. And that was about, it was 300,000 was the target. We beat that without any problem. Okay, and that was in AWS as well. It wasn't even real hardware. So on my laptop with one node, and I will run it if you're curious to see it, I can get about 150K on a one node MapR virtual box cluster on my little MacBook.
Are the microservices you showed in the diagram separate processes or JVMs, or are they somehow integrated into the main system?
Typically, when you talk about a microservice, it is a complete unit in and of itself. So most microservices deployments are done with things like Docker, right? So yes, there would be a JVM in there for that microservice or whatever runtime was needed. So, and that's one of the reasons that it gets to be a little tough, because you have to kind of balance. You have a JVM you have to run. It's got an interpretive level. You have a network you have to deal with, because you know you could put 20 Docker containers, but you only have one wire. Right, so you do have to kind of pay attention to that kind of thing. So that's typically why you see the consumers partitioned. So they're spread over 3 or 4 or 5 or 10 consumers. So that way the microservice doesn't have to be absolutely superpowered. You just have more of them. Right? So you're scaling horizontally to get the throughput that you need, rather than building, you know, Mongo boxes. So answer your question?
Sure.
Anyone else?
So what is the message durability call? If one of my broker went down, what's the chances that I'm going to miss the data?
That's a whole different discussion that our salespeople would love to have with you.
Yes.
So streaming into topics. In the MapR world, because of the way we do it, we actually replicate the stream. So if one, we don't have a broker in MapR, so we don't have the problem. Right? In Kafka, if you lose a broker, you can't guarantee where your cursor is. And that's the problem. You don't know where to go back to. You may partition it for loading, but you're going to have a loss in between it. Kafka is working on doing that in the Kafka code itself, so that the brokers will be able to handle a true failover, and they're very, very close. But remember, a publish-subscribe is not a transactional queue. So there's no semantics to say, give me that message, I got that message. That doesn't exist. It is, give me the message, oh, and by the way, I have to keep track of the last one I saw. So most of this is done on the client side in Kafka. So if it switches brokers, it's going to have some way to do that. And in actuality, what we demo is actually a way to do it.
So for instance, during partition rebalancing, right? Mm-hmm. What about Spark client will take care of that?
No. That's another issue, and that's a Spark specific thing. So we'll talk about some of the limitations actually is on this discussion. So this is what we're going to do. We want to be able to pick any one of these 2,300 senders and receivers. And I want to be able to look back 60 seconds. And I want to be able to do that in real time. And I want to be able to do it interactively. And by real time, I mean that if I do it this one, I'm going to see 60 seconds. If I wait 5 minutes, I'm going to see 60 seconds from 5 minutes in the future. Okay? The reason is that in this particular application, which was done for a proof of value for a large financial firm, they were monitoring the prices of the equities. They were monitoring who was doing the trading. That was their goal. They wanted to see who they were sending the trades to, and that was their other goal. So that was what they were trying to call. They didn't care if IBM was $20 or $100. They wanted to know that AE was doing all the trading, and why. Different reason. But it applies to everything. Equity price, equity volume, number of bid ask, okay? So a lot of these things would apply to any one of the things you want to watch that's in that record. It doesn't matter. You fan them out. Okay, you want to have a fan out for the equity symbol? Fine. You want to have a fan out for the senders and receivers? That's fine too. You want to have a fan out for the source exchange? No problem. Topics are cheap in MapR, all right? Whereas in Kafka, they are not. There's a limit. So in MapR, having 10,000 topics in one stream is not a big deal for us. This demonstration had, I think, about 5,000 when it was running at full speed. That would be difficult in Kafka to do, all right? The way we've implemented it is a little bit different. Okay. So we have that capability. Is that a good pitch?
Perfect. So one last question with that. So
sure.
Delivering messages at high volumes is something conscious of you've done forever, right?
Mm-hmm.
But your statement is kind of interesting because, okay, so if I'm watching the bid ask level 2 for depth, then I want to actually compare that against some historical data to maybe look at. who is then maybe accumulating or distributing on either side of that, and then figuring out some other sort of algo associated with that and get that to the next step. So what you're doing with that data once it lands, more than just putting it on a consumer,
right,
displaying it, so that's kind of the fascinating part of what hopefully you're going to show in terms of then what do you do with it out once you push it.
So let me go back two pictures. So the fact that it's a published subscribe means I can have n number of consumers.
Yeah.
So in one side of it, we're archiving it for that precise reason. We're putting it in a key value store so that I can get back to it relatively quickly, meaning with keyed access. Okay? This part up here, which is a totally separate thing, is doing the time windowing so that I can see it in real time. Now, the third part of what you just said would be to say, is to do anomalous behavior. Okay, so anomalous behavior would be I take this archive data and I build my baselines, my norms, over probably 3-4 years. And then I, up here in my Spark SQL, I say, what's the threshold plus and minus, and if it violates it, kick it out. And oh, by the way, if you go back to the slide prior to this, that would be a microservice. That would be something that says, okay, I'm watching this sender. Okay, this bank has been doing, here's his trades. I'm going to write to a stream everyone that's anomalous. Right? And that could be one little microservice, one JVM, that's all it does. And makes it easy to deploy, easy to code, and easy to maintain. And if you use a technology like Mesos or Docker or any one of them, probably don't need a VM for that kind of stuff. You can deploy it and move it very quickly and scale it very fast. Because if it's reading from a stream and writing to a stream, it doesn't matter which host it's on, does it? Doesn't need the file system either, does it? Right. So that's where this architecture kind of goes away from the traditional mechanisms that people are used to building. Right, so that design pattern has been built into people's heads for a million years. I write it into a database, I read it out of a database. Gemfire, they made Aerospike. KDB made millions off of that exact premise. I'm going to write everything into a relational database and I'm going to go window queries to go and look at the data. And their licenses fees are just inordinately large.
So you mentioned the user 60 seconds. That's your finest resolution.
No, that was an arbitrary number.
Because Spark does not go below that, right?
Right. Because, but what? When you see the code, you understand where Spark streaming doesn't play here. Okay. What looks like a Spark streaming app is micro batched. We're not doing that. Okay. We're actually using the Kafka consumer library to pull out exactly this offset to this offset on an interval that I set. Okay, so it's not Spark streaming in the way that a Spark programmer looks at it, but we're using Spark's Kafka libraries to get what I want. Does that answer your question? Okay, so code dive in. Everybody gonna get a little Java-ish, all right? All right, okay. So what do we need to do? This is what we're trying to accomplish. So we need to be able to look back n number of seconds on a topic or topics, but we're going to stick it to one. All right. So how do we do that? So Spark has in Spark Kafka streaming, the offsets and the cursors are maintained and managed by Spark. You don't get access to them via Scala. So somebody asked why I didn't do this in Scala. That's why. So when you start up Spark and you turn on Spark Streaming, or you build an RDD off a Kafka consumer, the offset's set to zero. So it goes right to the beginning. The next time you build the RDD, it goes from the last one it saw. Okay, that's fine if you're just going to do it sequentially. But if I need to move that window back, I can't do that. Okay, so I need another way to be able to do that. So Spark does have a cool feature called offsets, all right? And offsets allow me to create an RDD with a beginning and an end offset. I have to know what they are. They are not based on any kind of time or anything like that. It is a random number, not random. It is a sequential number, but has no direct meaning. It's not the number of messages. Okay? So you have to keep track of that. That's a Kafka API limitation, and it's just the way it works. And the reason is that when you partition, it has no concept of time, it has no concept of sequence. It only knows that this message started here and this message ended here. Okay, and that's all it knows. So we have to do some kind of manipulation to get that. So the way we do that is we create another topic that maintains those offsets. But the key to that topic is the timestamp. So I can find them very quickly and move back and forth. And there's code to do that. It actually iterates through it to do it. All right. What that does is it means that, and you're frowning, and it's a hard concept to get. What it allows me to do is, if I have a list of the offset and a timestamp for every offset, I can build an RDD and iterate it very quickly to find, well, we're going to go down to 931, and then I'm going to stop at 932. So 930 is this offset, 932 is this offset. Now I have the beginning and end, and I can go back and ask Spark to give me those Kafka events directly. So you actually build two RDDs here. One to find the time window you need, and a second one to actually get the data. Okay? This is Spark 1.6.1.8. How many people are on Spark 2? Anybody? Okay. Some of this disappears in 2.0. Not all of it. It's severely broken. Okay, so this code will work in 2.0. They are trying to... Spark wants to manage the cursors and the offsets. They want to do that inside in Spark streaming and in the RDD building engines, part of that code. And the rest of us want to control it ourselves. And so there's this fight going on. All right, the last thing is that I'm going to mention two other frameworks for streaming. The first one is Flink. It's an Apache project that has this exact functionality built in. You have Flink consume the stream. You say, Flink, I want you to do an aggregate for the last 60 seconds based on events, not on time. It's not a micro batch. So every time a trade comes in, it recalculates. And it keeps track of the timestamps and the offsets for you. If you're doing any of this kind of time window stuff on high-speed data, look at Flink. It's not the easiest thing to jump into, okay? But it is enormously powerful, and it's wicked, wicked fast. I mean, really, really fast. It will deal with 100K messages a second without too much problem. The second one is a product called StreamSets. And StreamSets does this, and it also is a nice thing to use because it has a beautiful graphical interface and it has a million data sources. So for your example with the anomaly detection, you would have stream sets would be reading that topic for IBM or that bank or that trading firm, and it would be able to do a query against some relational database where the anomaly thresholds were. And you can actually combine it in stream sets with a graphical interface and say every time it goes outside of this, write an entry to this stream. And it really is, it's drag and drop. It's a beautiful thing to demo, and it's great for building POCs, okay? It does run at high speed, but it requires more CPU than Flink does to do the same task, okay? And StreamSets is a California company. They have offices pretty much everywhere. We see them in New York, and we see them talking to a lot of financial companies because this is the kind of thing that they do. Once you build it in StreamSets, you can actually export it and make it a Spark char and just execute it. So there's a lot of benefits. But they have what they call their data controller is a runtime that does this for you. So I want to mention those. Those are some options. So I answered this question partially. I'll finish the answer. The code you're going to see is in Java, not in Scala. Right now, Spark Scala API into Kafka, the Kafka API, is not feature complete. The Java one is. Because the Java one is what Kafka was written in, so everything, I can get to everything. That includes things like get position and offsets that I can't get through Scala. In 2.0, Spark 2.0, that is there. It doesn't work with it. Okay, so you'll see, I'll show you the call in Java that you do. And what you'll find is you can do it in 2.0 on the Kafka consumers, but it doesn't necessarily return the right position. So be careful. So the cursor offset functions are the ones that are missing in Scala. They are in Java. They're missing in R, and they're missing in Python as well. And the last thing is that when we talk about D-streams, D-streams are time and microbatch based. D-streams, if you have a high velocity thing, you're going to run into problems. Basically because D-streams only has one receiver no matter how many executors you have in Spark. You can code around that and have multiple receivers running in different executors, but it's on you to manage it. And all of a sudden the sequence of how those events come in gets thrown to the wind. But you can't guarantee it anymore. You can't guarantee that they're coming in sequence. It's one of 20 executors again. So it's not necessarily a viable solution for something where you have to watch for trends. If you're just watching for an event, it's okay. Any questions on why we did what we did? Or why? The designer of the application is a guy named Ian McDonald, who's came, and Ted Dunning, who's our chief application officer, came up with the idea, and Ian sat down and actually coded it up. And it was for a particular financial, how can I word this? A financial information company, a very large financial information company.
Yep, that's good enough.
A well-known one. I mean, there aren't that many, so you can figure it out. All right, so talk about the code. So this is Spark Java. Okay, so this is using Spark Java API. All of this code, at the very end, you'll see a nice little GitHub URL. It's all available, it's all public, it's all free. Do with it what you want. All right, so the first thing we do is we create two topics, two consumers. One consumer is the data, and the other one is the offsets of the data. All right? And just to give you a general idea, this is just basic boilerplate code, but the key thing you have to keep in mind is we're actually doing two things. We're using the offset consumer to track the time and the offset at that moment in time. Okay? So now what we then have the ability to do is to say, give me an RDD and I can iterate through that and find the times I need to go after the actual data. Make sense? I mean, it's a overly complicated thing for something in our mind. It's very simple. I want to see the last 60 seconds. Right, well, yeah, computers don't work that way. Wish they did. So, what do we do? We have to get the initial range of data. We have to create the initial offsets. Okay? So, in Spark Java, on that consumer, you seek to the end of the topic. And you get the last offset, the final one. So this gives you a position, right? So now you have a number that is your start, okay? The reason is that then I want to build my RDD, and I say start at zero and go to the latest offset. So now what I've done is I've just built and said, give me everything you've got once. Remember I said, yeah, I had to do this once? This is when you do it. So we start at zero, and we go to the end that I just got here. Our topic, being clever naming convention guys, is our topic plus dash offset. So it's a very simple thing. You asked about changing midstream. That string would have to change. So So you would have to redo this calculation if you flipped the topic name in the middle of the day. So then we just go out and we say, let's build an RDD that gives me all of what I just asked for. And I get the whole thing. Not particularly wonderful, but I need to have a consumer to find these, to find the times and dates. And I go and I get them all out. So in Scala, this would be one line of chained code, wouldn't it? Yeah, isn't that nice? Yeah, I love Java. I learned Java from 1.0, and let me tell you something, I'm writing it in Scala every single time if I can do it. All this does is it does a collect, and it goes out and it says, build me an RDD that has everything in that topic. Just to give you a general idea, these syntaxes look familiar, right? Okay? The first item, the second item. And basically all we're doing is saying, we're parsing them into numbers, so the tuple looks like just two numbers. We need that when we get out. But that code, all of this stuff, is that one.math in Scala. One line. That's why you want to use Scala. Okay? But what it gives us is it gives us a list to iterate through. So now I have an RDD that has all the data, every single message that's been received on that topic. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to iterate through them, and in the data itself, in the top data, is the timestamp down to the millisecond. Right? So as I go through, I can say offset timestamp, offset timestamp, offset timestamp, and I just populate it that way. And that's all I'm doing. All of that code just to give us the ability to build a time window. Again, you only have to do this once. Then you do it iteratively, like every second or 2 seconds or 3 seconds. Okay? And that code comes a little bit later. Okay, now we get the data we want. Because now I have the offsets. Now I know what to do. So getting offsets in Spark, Kafka is actually pretty easy. Because all you have to do is create this offset range, this one. You give it a first one and a last one. And then you say, give me an RDD with those offset ranges, and then you can chain whatever you want after that. That is what, it doesn't exist in Scala. If I could do this in Scala, that Java code would disappear. It's this one, right here. This does not exist in Scala. Too bad, and this is what exists in 2.0, but doesn't work right. So be careful. It's coming. But the idea now here is that rather than having the whole stream from beginning to end, if I turn on a consumer and say start reading, it starts at the first event it has, and it's going to read through the end. And that's not very useful, especially if you restart in the middle of the day. Right? 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I don't care about 9:30. This gives you that ability, and this is how you do this in Spark, in Java. I know this is kind of deep code, but the idea here is that's what you want to do. So then what do you do with it? So we do something with the data. So now I have this RDD, and in my map function, in this particular case, all we did here in the map function was we parsed out a bunch of things, and we cast it to another class. So, I mean, you can do whatever you want. We just print it out. I mean, you want to read some piece of data out of the record, that's fine. But you do it in that map function. Okay, so in Scala, you would actually, inside the map, you do a string parse to get your data, whatever you want out of there. Volume, price, sender, receiver, whatever you need. In our case, we just put it into a class called tick. So it populates a bunch of fields. So far, this all makes sense. I went really fast. Conceptually, what I'm trying to get to is how this works. Okay? I don't have a whiteboard. But so does everybody understand how you're going to have to move to get data in and out in a time window?
How is that call method getting sent to the rest of the code?
It's inside the map. Okay, so if you go back a slide, this code would be in here. Okay, it got so small when I put it in there, I didn't want to do that. But anything could be in that map. I mean, because functionally, I mean, all you're doing is the call. This in Java, this function call up here is what gets called for every line in the map. Okay, and you're writing the map function is basically what you're doing. All right, so this down here gets iterated for every event between this range and this range, those two offsets. You're going to see that. You're not going to see anything after it. You're not going to see anything before it. So if you can keep track of the offsets in any way you want, we happen to use an RDD to do it and another stream. You can use this functionality to pull sections of a stream out. So you're actually querying a live stream that's being written to at a very high rate and saying, I want 2 minutes ago and I only want this off these offsets. Meanwhile, they're coming in at 1,000 a second and all I'm getting is what I asked for. Okay, so this gives you the ability to query a stream. Now, conceptually, that's hard. People who came from the message queue world, how many have dealt with any kind of message queuing? MQ, Rabbit, any of that stuff. You know that once you get that message, you can't go back. You're done. You hack it, you own it. And if you lose it, you're done, because you really can't go backwards. Publish, subscribe streams are more like a live database. Because, A, we don't have transactional semantics, so things don't get popped off the queue. And B, we can never know when a consumer is going to join and subscribe. Right? So the consumers one consumer subscribes at zero, the next guy does it 5 minutes later. Well, what does he see? Does he see, he can pick, can show me it all or show me only the new ones? Okay, so in that sense, we have to keep a certain amount of time available in the stream. So the stream becomes an authoritative source of data. It becomes a database that you can query. And Kafka and MapR streams have the ability to set that time to live. That's what the TTL does. It says that I'm going to keep 900 seconds of data. If you look at the code on the GitHub, you'll see that we set a TTL of 900. So it's 900 seconds. So after 900, at second 901, messages at the beginning just get deleted and will never appear again, no matter when a consumer joins. And the offsets are now different, which is why, by the way, which is why Spark messes it up. Because it resets it to zero, and it's not zero. So that's how this works. So you have an authoritative source of data. It's available to you for some period of time. And you can control the amount of time that it's there. And using this kind of technique, I can just go in and pull out sections of it in time, or numbers of messages, or whatever you're doing. In some cases, it may be numbers of events. I don't really care what they are, but I want to see the volume between point A and point B. So this technique works no matter what. Right. And to the map function that's in there in Java, in Scala, this would be print line. Okay? I mean, realistically. If you wanted to cast it into that cool little tip class, you could do that as well. Okay, so a couple of things on performance. The top one is number one. Streams and topics are cheap. Processing streams and topics are expensive. Okay, the cost of producing, publishing into a stream, and consuming from a stream is extremely small. Okay, there's no impact, there's no overhead, and from a processor perspective, it takes almost no time. We're talking fundamentally instantaneous. So rather than having a stream and a big hunk of processing and then writing to another stream, it is better to have multiple steps, small little processing steps. They may be as simple as saying, okay, we don't want the whole record, I just want the first 80 characters. So I chop it and I put the 80 characters into a stream, and the next guy picks up. Now he's got the data set he needs. Okay? That has been found to be a performance boost because I can scale that. Where I can't scale one single vertical process, I can scale horizontally with streams really easily. And that applies to Kafka and MapR, and all streaming technology works out. Okay, so that's a big performance boost. In our world, JSON has become, right or wrong, a de facto standard for storing data. The reason is that it's really easily parsed. It's very data type agnostic. There's only two data types in JSON, or three, I take that back. There's a Boolean. There's a string and a number and a Boolean, okay? It makes it easy and very low impact to parse. Okay, the cost of parsing JSON is nothing. Remember those SAX parsers from XML? Has ever had to do that? I see smiles in the back. Those were low overhead things, weren't they? Okay, so JSON really, really is, because you can write it in JavaScript and it's very fast. So it's one of the reasons you'll see JSON as a way to pass messages, and they compress really nicely. So you can tighten the data down pretty well. Raw data into multiple topics. That fan-out idea allows you to scale horizontally a big fat data pipe into very small ones that are user or process or whatever specific. And a big trading desk, okay, where they're looking at the equities. This one was looking at the buyers and the sellers, right? That's a kind of a back office thing. But there may be traders who want to look at the price and the volume. They can use the same raw data stream, the big fat one, and just span it out a different way. Or fan it out multiple ways. And it becomes real easy. And because then this stream and these topics, these are the prices. Oh, these stream and these topics, those, that's the volumes. Oh, and this one's the senders and this one's the receivers. And it becomes very simple. And it looks really fat and complicated, but because they're all strings, they're easily changed and easily maintained. Right? And oh, by the way, if I read all the topics off the raw stream once, I can do a map and do an aggregate and get all the names. So it's pretty easy. And the last thing is my own little thing. Do not ever build an application in Java for Kafka that does not have a JUnit test at speed. And good Java programming practice, but one of the things that you will find out is that streaming behavior, when it begins to get very large, what you assumed when you had one producer and one consumer, things like in order and sequence, do not apply when you scale out. So you need to make sure that your application will behave as expected when I go to 10 partitions. Okay? I leave that as a subtle reminder and of painful experience. Very painful experience. So, we'll take a stop. Questions?
Do you have an example of the JUnit-based test?
In the GitHub, which we're going to go to in a second, yes, the JUnits for this particular application are there. And if they're not, I will get Nick to put them there. Pretty sure they're there. Any other questions?
So you said that there will be two topics. One is to keep the time and the offset, and there is other one.
Right, it's the actual data. It's the data pipe. So you have this thing called, let's say, IBM. Mm-hmm. And so IBM trades 10,000 in a minute. Mm-hmm. You know, it's 10,000 events. So what I need to know is, I need to know at minute zero what the offset was, and at minute one what the offset was, so that I can pull out that minute's range out of the stream. So we use a topic to do that, because I can query the topics inside Spark and create an RDD from them. So we'll jump out of our old friend here, we'll go over to this two things first. So you asked a while back how we do that and why we build two topics, okay? So in essence, what we have to do here is we're actually building this topic so that I can do this piece of code right where my cursor is. And all that does is it's reading that RDD, okay? Because I have the RDD now, okay? Here's all my timed offsets. I've mapped them out. So now I have an RDD that contains two pieces of information, two integers, or actually they're longs. One is the time, okay, one is the offset. So now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna iterate really quick through that to find the first offset I need and the last offset I need based on the time. In Flink, you don't have to do this. In Flink, you just say, give me the window starting 2 minutes ago. Give me 60 seconds. And it's actually keeping track of that internally to Flink. You're replicating that functionality here in Spark. Spark will probably add that since they seem to want to do this kind of stuff. And people want to use Spark to do this. So, but basically that's all I'm doing. You can go through and you'll see I get the first one and turn it into a time, right? Now I have a time date. And so that's how I do it.
So through this technique, you can go back to any time and get the data?
As long as the data is still in the stream.
Okay, so if the retention time, log retention time is,
right,
is less is, than...
In this particular case, I set it to 900. They set it to 900. Oh, I set it to 900 when I created the topic.
So by default, what is the log? This depends on log retention time, right? The segments live in the cluster, like default time is seven days or something.
Yeah. So yes, we alter that here.
Okay.
When I create the stream and the topic, I put a TTL of 900 on it. Default 7 days. And I will tell you that if you had to go read the offsets minute by minute over 7 days of TAC data, that in and of itself would take a long time. It's probably not something you're going to want to do. That's something you're going to want to put into a key value store or a database. Because at the point at which this becomes ineffective, yes, you can query the stream that way, but in real time, it's not going to be effective. It'll take too long. The other requirement of this application, by the way, was to return this information with a query, total query latency of under 3 seconds. I'm not going to go through 7 days of data in 3 seconds.
So what should be the TTL there?
I think the TTL, and I'll look at the stream creates, I believe the TTL is 900, what I did. So, what does the stream look like? Okay, so this is a one-node MapR cluster. It's running on this machine. Okay, I am logged into it via SSH, so that you kind of get an idea of where we are, right? And so if I want to go look at a stream, so let's just take a look at, it's called Tacford. Yeah, trade and quote. So let's find out a little bit about the stream itself. All right, so this is one big stream. Okay, yeah, see the TTL number? Right there, so when I created the stream, I put a TTL on it.
So the Spark is streaming, right? You can set the batch size of the Spark stream 1 minute and then you can do this same thing?
Yes, you could do this in Spark streaming, but you would never be able to go backwards because Spark streaming against the Kafka stream or topic, it keeps track of the offset. So once that stream, that microbatch is done, it resets the start offset to the last one. You cannot go backwards in Spark streaming, which is why you'll notice we didn't use Spark streaming, D streams, in our example. That's why.
So with this application, you cannot go portable, right? Because you run the...
Well, the future hasn't happened yet.
No, it happened, but you don't update your last offset.
Oh, in the code, what you'll see is that we put a consumer timeout. So basically, in Kafka, when the event is received, it will execute the loop. So each event. So what we do is we say, every, I believe it's about a second, we're going to update the consumer offset topic. That's how we do it. So we take the position every second, and we say, at this timestamp, it's this.
So you can update it.
Yes. So you're doing this maintenance. You're keeping track every second or every minute or whatever your time over is of what the offset is on that topic. Okay, you have to do that because there's no other way to get it.
And you just update that part only, right? You don't have to do the whole loop.
You don't have to do the rest of it. Only time you need that is when you have to go back and retrieve a piece out that you want to build an RDD to query. Say, I want to see 5 minutes of this. Okay, then you need to go back in and say, what are the offsets for 5 minutes ago? And then you can take it out of the stream. You can actually build an RDD from that. All right, so that's what our stream looks like. There's actually some data in it. And so to give you an idea, somebody was asking about how fast this runs. Can you see those numbers? Down there, that's the test state set. So that's one node at 174,000 messages a second. Okay, the messages are small, I'll grant you, but they are the actual TAC records. So they're about 75-ish bytes. That is on this machine running in a virtual box. The reason that works, and this is MapR hat goes on. The reason this works is because it's all running on one single platform. I don't have to have a separate Kafka cluster. Right, so that command that I did here, Alright, so the command I did where I showed the stream, actually is running just a command line. I gotta get rid of the message. There it is. So over here. So it shows me that's what the actual stream looks like. Now inside the stream you can have multiple topics. Okay? The stream in our world would be the equivalent of a data table, which is actually how it's implemented. So we can have n number of topics inside each stream, n number of streams. So MapR in the sense that we can stream this. On this particular little one-node cluster, I had 10,000 topics without any problem, and it didn't see any kind of slowdown.
Is it the same implement? Is your MapR implementation of Kafka?
It's vastly different because there are no brokers.
So this is not the Kafka map?
The API is Kafka's API, so to Spark, it looks exactly the same.
Oh, but internally it's different?
But internally, it is not the same, no.
What about cloud? They use Kafka?
They use, that would be a standard Kafka cluster that would either run on the nodes of the Cloudera cluster or be a, under director, you might have a separate Kafka and a separate Hadoop depending on your Cloudera configuration. Horton is Horton. They really do want you to build separate ones. Cloudera, I've seen it done both ways. It doesn't really matter. At high volume, though, you have to be a little careful. Kafka, by default, uses a local file system, okay? And at very high volumes, you're going to probably want to put the Kafka cluster on a separate cluster. The MapR, it doesn't really matter, because it's the impact of 10,000 streams and 300,000 a second. It doesn't really impact the cluster at all. Does that answer your question? Okay, so the other So the GitHub that has all this stuff on it, because it's the right place. All right, there's a lovely explanation written by the guy who wrote the application, Nick Amato, and it explains actually how to do the demo. So you can actually see how it does. We create a stream, okay, and we put our TTL on it. And this one just shows me the information. We create a topic. You don't have to create a topic. MapR will automatically create the topic. We do it in this case because we chose to, because we wanted to indicate the number of partitions. By default, it'll come up with one partition, okay? And it'll show you what it looks like. Okay, so that's pretty simple, right? So the data that we send across looks like this. All right, that's why the records are, as I said, the records are very small, but they do run pretty well. So it'll show you the demo. What I wanted to show you is to go back down and look at some of the other things that you can do with this data. So the big demo that we built actually used Zeppelin as the visualization. So everybody familiar with Apache Zeppelin? Oh, yeah, I know you are. Any in the back? You heard of Apache Zeppelin? No? How about Spark Notebook? Okay. Apache Zeppelin is a not language specific, not as good as Spark Notebook. Okay? If you're writing Scala straight, I'd use Spark Notebook. If you're mixing Java and Scala, IPython is probably a better choice. Zeppelin is also pretty decent. But Zeppelin's pretty simple. Oops. Well, that's not going to be helpful, is it?
Did you connect or not?
No, I didn't connect to anything. I didn't know I could.
Do you need to?
No, I was going to show them a nice picture. So, Zeppelin allows you to like do queries. So you can write Spark SQL, and it will display things like these nice little graphics. I wish I could show you a bigger picture. But fundamentally, it is a notebook like Spark Notebook with a limited set of visualizations. You can add multiple little queries on one page in the web page. So it makes a quick visualization. It's great for demos. You can put it in production. We have customers who've done it. They add like little Spark SQL queries that refresh every 5 seconds and it revisualizes this stuff on the fly. Not a bad tool. A little fragile on the install, but you know, it's an Apache project, it's still incubating. So forewarned is forearmed. You've been warned. The last thing I wanted to show you is that so our fan out, I gotta go back up to the command. So the fan out is going to show you, we said it's going to build topics for each one of these. So I've run the fan out on this particular stream. So I think so inside that stream there's actually I didn't run it. I take that back, I'm sorry. There would be all the senders and receivers. Actually, you know what? I'll just run it so that we have some data to look at. So I'll just run it again. So the actual the producer application that just writes it in the stream. Okay? So information that's on there, the stream names at the end, I'm putting it in. User mapr tap colon trades, that's the topic I'm going to write to. The data file I'm going to use. Okay. Actually, I'm going to go back and use the one I know has good clean data in it. Yeah, that one. So just turn it on. Okay, so I don't know. It's going a little slow. I wrote 150,000 messages in 3 seconds. I guess that's pretty good. So now we can go look at the topic list. And the reason I'm doing this is not because I want to show you this. I just want you to see what, how this fans out. Okay, so now there's all we've got. Wow, that's actually a lot of data. I'm kind of surprised. The buyers, yes, the buyers and sellers. So you can actually go and get, actually look at. Okay, so now I have, if I go in, I will see that there is one sender, one receiver, so there's a topic for each one of you. It could be equities, it could be anything that you want, it doesn't really matter. Now the problem with Kafka here, in this particular scenario, is you're going to be limited on your Kafka cluster to how many topics you can do. Okay? We've found through testing, and we have customers who run Kafka on top of MapR, you know, the actual regular old Kafka with brokers. It gets to about 1,000, about 1,500 topics, and the performance begins to degrade pretty quick. Okay, so you won't get the throughput level that you would on MapR streams. It stays very constant until there's some magic point and it just fades off very quickly. So the issue is that if you had to build this application where you're spanning 8,000 equities, you'd need multiple Kafka clusters. So from the client perspective, now I have to talk to three brokers to get the data. Well, how do I know which broker has which? Well, I gotta look it up. And all of a sudden your thing gets really complex really quick. Right? If you have a small number of topics, okay, 500,000, you're probably okay. But the minute you get up in scale, you begin to run into the problems and the limitations of Kafka itself. Now Kafka will do 400 to 500K a second through a set of brokers with a decently partitioned set of topics. Okay? In one cluster. That's pretty good, right? But if I need to build a topic-based application where we're using the design pattern that I talked about tonight, that's not going to work because I can't do it, right? So IoT becomes a real problem real quick. If I want to build a topic for every sensor, it's not going to work. It's not going to scale out that. And then you get into multiple Kafka clusters, and then you get into building failover for multiple Kafka clusters, and selecting which broker I need to talk to, depending on which data I'm after, and your complexity goes up. That was a MapR pitch, if you want to put that in parentheses. We have a lot of customers who have successfully done things at this scale. And we have a lot of customers who use Kafka on top of MapR and have done things at very high rates, but not a lot of topics. And they're looking at the design pattern and realizing that they have to build very, very high speed, very high throughput clients in order to use Kafka at that rate. 300K is a lot. And 300K per second is a lot of data to move. So at that point, we'll open it up for questions, comments. Yes.
I just want to be sure that I understand. This is designed for a specific type of data use. If you fan it out, if you then needed to basically unfan it, say you want to arbitrage the SPX, and so you need a huge number of socks, that would be not well, this would not be well designed for that, correct?
So what I would do is rather than fanning it out to each individual entity, I would fan it out to the SPX. In other words, I would have the microservice that's doing the fan out, rather than fan it all the way down to the individuals, I would have it fan out only the list of the SPX. Same thing would be with the Dow or any of the other indexes like that. Because you're talking about 100 equities, fan it out to 100 just to bring it back together doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So make a new topic that's called Dow. And it is all the components of the Dow or all the components of S&P. Yeah, this design pattern is more for the end user where he's got he may want to pick 1 or 5 or 10 or 20, and day to day you don't know what he's going to pick. Right, so rather than tying him to have to, you have to rebuild those topics based on what the user wants, you just say, here's the list, go pick the ones you want to subscribe to, a little checkbox on a web page or whatever. He clicks OK, and his application says, I'm going to subscribe to these 20. Right? Could you do that with the SPX? Sure, why not? Do you want the users doing stupid things like that? Probably not. They will make a mistake. Inevitably, they will make a mistake. Any other questions?
You've been talking a lot about microservices. Can you, where are the microservices? Have you shown any? Did you refer to microservices as microservices to the things that were doing the mapping?
Yes. So the microservices that we built out for this particular one are the producers and consumers, specifically the mapper. All right, because that was an easy one to do, because it's completely self-contained. It is fed from a stream and it writes out to streams. It was Dockerized in like 2 seconds flat. Okay, and the Docker file consisted of install Java, git clone, execute, and the entry point was the command line, and that was it. Okay, keep it simple, stupid, because that way, if I need to have an SPX one, all I got to do is take that Docker file and change, he needs to write to this topic. Or it needs to be this jar to run rather than the other one. And I can deploy 100 of those. And I can put those on the same host really, really easily. Right? All I need is the MapR or Kafka client software, and I'm set. So as a microservice, it becomes... Okay, I look at a microservice as a very well-defined thing. It has to have a couple of properties. First off, if I have to write a Docker file more than 20 lines, it fails right off the bat. If I can't do from Ubuntu, install Java, git clone, entry point, it fails, first thing. Second thing is that it has to be completely location independent. Because if I turn on Docker Swarm and I have 20 of these Dockerd's running, I got to A, be able to scale it, because I might want 4 or 5 of them, and B, if that Dockerd number 2 goes down, I need to be able to move it around. So it has to be location independent. Streams makes that so easy, right? Because you don't care. All you got to know is where to get the stream. The stream could be local, could be in another Docker container, it could be in another data center. Doesn't matter. So if you can build a box around it, it's really simple. And streams makes microservices dead simple. There's no persistent state. All the state is persisted in the stream, right? Because I can query the stream. I can do all these cool things with the stream. I don't have to worry about persisting it at the Docker level. Does that make sense? So in this example, the producer and the consumers, of which there were 3, were in Dockers. And they happen to be running on different hosts. It didn't matter. They could have run on the same host. Okay? The other microservice for you would be aggregation. Okay, where you have a stream for every equity. Now I want to build a stream that's the S&P. So I can have a microservice that says subscribe to the S&P and put it out as the S&P data. So I can actually bring it back together and put it into a different stream. So yeah, you could do it that way, or you could do it as a service on its own just for the S&P at the very beginning. So answer the question?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm a big fan of this in the Hadoop world, and it's become a design pattern that I'm seeing more and more. And the reason is that when Hadoop started out, you had to build a Hadoop cluster. And it had to be Hadoop, and everything in it was all tied together as a Hadoop cluster, and it was this black box. And that was fine when it first came out. People got used to it, people got playing with big data, they did some analytics, they learned how to use their data sets, they played around with them, a lot of fun, okay? Now all of a sudden, they're looking at it, it's like, I got 50 servers there, I run 3 Hive jobs a day, those things are sitting idle. And I spend big bucks for those things. So now what they're doing is they're saying, okay, let's use the Hadoop distributed file system or the MapR file system and run Docker on top of it and run Hadoop in there too. and we do that all the time. We have a lot of customers who are looking at exactly that paradigm, which then makes microservices really, really simple. Because you have a distributed file system, I can put my Docker images down there, my Docker files, I can put my overlay file systems on a distributed file system, makes Docker stupid simple, and the only thing you need to do is use Swarm to start the containers. So that is becoming a very, and I'll show you a picture afterwards of what I'm talking about, but that is the paradigm. The microservices idea in the Hadoop world is, if you look at the node manager and the resource manager, okay, in a Hadoop YARN cluster, they are functionally, other than the file system, they have to be able to access HDFS, they're functionally independent. They can be Dockerized, and a lot of customers do that, so that they can utilize the box for other things. People are using Mesos to do the same thing. Okay, or a combination of the two. Okay? Streams and microservices is probably the most common thing I'm seeing now, because people who did this microservices where they had to have a persistent store, right? Where if you had 20 web servers, they had to have a persistent store. Even session, even Redis as a session layer is a persistent store. That made it complicated. Streams makes it super simple, right? Very, very simple. Does that give you a little better light? And in big data, it's real simple, because now we have tools like Kafka to do that kind of stuff. It makes it very simple. Any other questions, comments? Oh, I got to go back to the last slide. You need like all the code information. Let's come back on. So, the okay. So next steps, just for fun. So where's all this stuff? GitHub, MapR-demos. Everything that you saw here tonight, including all the Java code, sample data sets. I think even the Zeppelin notebooks are up there. Okay. Plus the documentation, all there, okay? The actual data files come from this thing called nyxdata.com. Now, the stock exchange is a profit-making organization, and if you want real data, you're gonna pay big money for it. However, they have nice samples. So you can get, like for example, ours was a single daily TAC file. You can get one day's worth of all of the data that the NYSE will give you. So that goes down to bid and ask, that goes down to BBO and NBBO and all that. It's a million of them, okay? So if you want to play with different data sets, you can get one day for free, all right? You want more than that, it's $3,000 a month for the base package, and it goes on from there. NASDAQ has a similar thing as well, as do the European bourses. So help yourself. This is actually kind of fun because it's very well spec'd out. And writing the code for this was very simple because they give you the file formats and everything. Also down at the bottom, we built a little teeny website, or a microsite that has where we're putting more of these applications and samples. Okay, so this use case was a financial use case. There's other use cases that we're doing that are also available. Okay. And yes, I will publish the slide deck. Somebody's already asking. So this is my email. This is Matt Castriotta's email. He's the local Boston systems engineer, the guy with the coat and the tie.
It looks like a sales guy.
So contact one of us if you have questions. As a last sales point, we have a downloadable sandbox. We also have a community edition of MapR with zero cost. It includes all that streaming technology built in for free. So you can actually start building this out at the cost of the physical on-prem hardware or VMs. Okay, so go play. The sandbox that is available on our website is okay, but it has every Hadoop component installed. So you might want to uninstall the Hadoop components, like Hive, Data, Uzi, Scoop, Ben, just about everything else. You name it, it's there. It's easy enough to build a VM image that you can fire up that just has the basic stuff that you need to do the streaming applications. This is really only two or three packages that you need to do. So remember, it's all built in. You don't build a Kafka cluster, you install MapR, you install the client library, and that's all you do. And that's how you build the data. Okay? Questions? Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.